Oh, hello. Well, hello there. Where did you all come from? Thank you all for being here. I'm Novella Ford. I'm the Associate Director of Public Programs and Exhibitions at the Schomburg Center. And before we get started with this program, I just wanted to make sure that, one, everybody had a handy-dandy brochure and schedule. If you don't, there's a tent over there with some big placards hanging from it. It also might say welcome. They're on the table there, so make sure you get that. It'll let you know what's happening by hour. I hope you've been enjoying yourselves thus far. Let's see, we're at the 1:30 hour, so right now we're about to have the conversation around Black food stories with Bryant Terry downstairs in the Aaron Douglas Reading Room inside the Schomburg Center. Is Clevis Natera, who is a debut fiction author, and her book Naruto on the Park, and Jacinda Townsend will be reading from her book Mother Country, and it'll be moderated by bookstagrammer, brown girl book lover Leslie Ann Murray. So if you have friends who are around or wondering what they can get into and maybe late for this one, there are some other programs happening throughout the Schomburg that'll start in another 15 minutes or so. But anyway, this will give you that. I also want to make sure that you all know that we have fantastic swag for the Literary Festival. So this book, this bag is one of those things. It says reading rebellious, joyful, necessary. So after coming off of a season where reading has really been prescriptive in some ways, I want to make sure that we think about all the ways in which reading is also a joyful act. And as well as a rebellious act, you know, for those who were enslaved at a period of time, you weren't allowed to learn how to read. You weren't allowed to choose the kind of information that you wanted to take in. So let's not take this freedom for granted. So if all minds are clear, we all have these, say yay. Okay, right on. Ryan is here. Fantastic. So I feel like this is a person who really shouldn't need any introduction, but I'll just say a little bit. Bryant Terry's Black Food, he will be in conversation with Summer Sewell, like Jewel, and she is the senior editor at Guardian US. She has written about restaurant industry and food systems across the U.S. with a particular focus on the struggles of Black farmers. She's also a contributor to Black Food, which is Bryant Terry's latest book. Now, if you don't have his other cookbooks, they're really fantastic. It was because of Bryant that I suddenly wanted to open an African spice shop, because all of the spices in that other book were so incredible. But I love that you're leaning into Black joy in telling these histories through this book. Now, if you don't know, Bryant Terry is a James Beard and NAACP Image Award-winning chef, educator, and author of renown, and is renowned for his activism to create a healthy, just, and sustainable food system. He is the founder and editor-in-chief of Four Color Books, an imprint of Penguin Random House and 10 Speed Press, which I look forward to hearing more about this new imprint. His sixth book, A Collection of Recipes, Art, and Stories, which Black Food we're here to talk about, was published by Four Color Books and 10 Speed Press in October of last year. It went on to be the most critically acclaimed American cookbook published. So thank you all for joining us. I will turn it over to Bryant and Summer.
Hi, everyone. All right. So, Bryant, it's so good to be here with you today. It's nice to see you. We've been friends for a long time, but we haven't really caught up. So I've been looking forward to this. And you're going to start today by reading part of the intro to your latest book, which is Black Food.
I just want to say it's really amazing being on stage with Summer, because we met about a decade ago.
At least.
When she was an intern for California Magazine and Pop-Up. It was an event that they did, and it was like Barry Jenkins and me and some other folks. So
I don't know how I had the courage to go up to you and Barry Jenkins and introduce myself, but I'm glad that I did.
And so look at you now. So anyway, I'm just going to read a quick excerpt from the introduction of the book, and then we'll jump into the conversation. So I start with a quote by Audre Lorde. Sometimes we are blessed with being able to choose the time and the arena and the manner of our revolution. but more usually, we must do battle where we are standing. Black food is a communal shrine to the shared culinary histories of the African diaspora. These pages offer up gratitude to the great chain of black lives and to all the sustaining ingredients and nourishing traditions they carried and remembered through time and space to deliver their kin into the future. Every one of us who came together to make this book invoked sacred energies to support the creation of a beautiful, delicious, and thought-provoking compendium. We pray that this collection facilitates reflection on and veneration of our sacred foodways. Recipes are the through line of black food. Without being overly prescriptive, I ask brilliant colleagues to offer dishes that embody their approach to cooking and draw on history and memory while looking forward. I encourage you to make many recipes in this book and to create space for meaningful, visceral experiences. Trust me, the food will provide more sustenance, more nourishment, more health, more pleasure, and more life. But that's not all. Black food also includes moving visual art, thought-provoking essays, and imaginative poetry that will encourage spiritual and intellectual exploration, renewal, and growth. We seek in these pages to promote a concept of food that embraces courage, commitment, and self-discovery, and ultimately moves each and all of us to a better place. In my graduate school advisor, Robin D.G. Kelly's 1994 essay collection, Imagining Home, Class, Culture, and Nationalism in the African Diaspora, I discovered a profound rumination by the late South African scholar activist Bernard Magobane. Diasporic consciousness arose from a, quote, a determined effort to, on the part of black people to rediscover their shrines from the wreckage of history. In this book, this altar, we lay out and lay on it the collective weight, the push of experiences and traditions of the African diaspora, the movement of black bodies and black food far and wide, from pre-Columbian voyages out of Africa to the violent dislocations of the transatlantic slave trade and colonialism. This collection also urges us to stop and dive deeply into the politics of pleasure and rest, as in Trisha Hersey's concept of the Nap Minister. Y'all know about Trisha Hersey, the Nap Minister? Get up on her. Y'all need to go to sleep right now, according to Trisha Hersey. Concept of Nap Ministry and R&R as resistance and of black leisure, whether stretching out to chill and sip beautiful drinks in the afternoon at Oakland's Red Bay Coffee or strolling through Paris all evening with nowhere specific to be, brushing dirt off one's shoulder like the flies flaneur. We subscribe to the philosophies of Toni Morrison, a joyful warrior wielding her quill and freedom dreaming, insisting we shut out the nightmarish distractions of racism. We let Morrison show us how, with a fresh pair of eyes, we can perceive a world full of light, love, peace, pleasure, and rewards previously denied. We are grateful for Sarah Ladipo Manyika's remembrance, Jolofing with Toni Morrison, and for Penguin Random House editor Portia Burke's wealth of wisdom and experience, whether in guiding the 35th anniversary reissue of Morrison's groundbreaking Black Book, a major inspiration for the volume before you, or the reissue of the autobiography of Malcolm X. In our Black Queer Food chapter, we are fortunate to witness the most profound dialogue by and about our diaspora's most marginalized and most resilient and brilliant community. Ebony Durr, Lazarus Lynch, Zoe Ajonia, and Lee Gaiman Jones lead us in a timely conversation about how LGBTQ activism is the vanguard of creating vibrant culture, love, and kinship out of disruption and rejection. Crucial to us thriving is creating the broadest table with seats reserved for all of our people throughout the diaspora. Like the black men depicted in Kerry James Marshall's Garden Project, a series of large-scale paintings set in Chicago's South Side, we should all weed, rake, and dig deeply to uproot the attitudes, habits that marginalize, reject, or erase any one of us. The many mansions of black food have always had and will always have room for everyone. As our clear-sighted black liberation activist Anna Julia Cooper insisted, each soul can and should decide when and where they enter into this rich tradition. Our aim in black food is to maintain this practice of openness, to encourage the sharing of these journeys and discoveries across the diaspora at large. Black food is rich with points of connection in which the reader can engage with and perhaps more deeply appreciate the many colored threads in this diasporic epic of black exodus and redemption. Each chapter and verse, each poem, photograph, painting, think piece, and recipe is a portal to beloved communities of plants and animals, foods and pleasures, leisures, taste, and cultures across many eras. Learn how to make sacred spaces suited to your own home and kitchen at your own pace of growth. Perhaps you will begin with something simple and soothing like Crystal Mac's update on a traditional Yoruba okra bath. Or you may be drawn to the more elaborate practices as with Latham Thomas's and Jocelyn Jackson's guidance for intentional ritual creation, altar making, and seed weaving. Black food is an offering in which the contributors, whether chefs, artists, activists, scholars, journalists, or poets, seek to honor a pantheon of revered ancestors. We deify Octavia Butler in Caring for the Whole Through This Black Body, Adrienne Marie Brown's introduction to our chapter on radical self-care. Audre Lorde's life and legacy are writ large across that chapter's focus on defining, nurturing, and defending oneself, as are other spiritual forebears like bell hooks and Cedric Robinson. We stand on iconic shoulders like those of Black liberation theologians Reverend James H. Cone and Albert Klieg in our chapter on spirituality. Intellectual titans like W.E.B. Du Bois inform deeply personal reflections like Beyond the Tree Line, Rashad Fraser's return to his native North Carolina's rural spaces, disrupting the racist histories of color lines. With Therese Nelson and Rahana Bizra Martinez, we give thanks to visionaries like Lena Richard and Verna Mae Smart Grosner, whose prescient critiques of the U.S. evolution from domestic food work to professional kitchens help us find footing for Black creativity and entrepreneurship in a booming food media landscape. With Tracy McGurder and Fred Opie, we cherish Dick Gregory, who in the tradition of prophetic truth tellers like Elijah Muhammad, Peter Tosh, Coretta Scott King, and KRS-One, aggressively rejected the toxic food traditions of slavery, colonialism, and industrialized food systems. In Land Liberation and Food Justice and Black Women, Food and Power, inspired by the ingenuity of celebrated grassroots organizers like Fannie Lou Hamer and Georgia Gilmore, our contributors Monica White, Charlene Carruthers, and Psyche Williams-Forsum explore how Black folks fought for life and liberty by leveraging fecund land and delicious food. In the name of these ancestors, we claim and reclaim radical models of food, health, and wellness for Black communities, revolutionary not in their newness, but also in their rootedness in ancient African traditions. This book is a Sankofa Birds, standing astride the crossroads of past and present with a neck craning back to what came before, measuring our progress. Its feet pointed toward what is to come with an egg signifying the future, held protectively in her beak. To paraphrase Zora Neale Hurston, the present is an egg laid by the past that has a future inside of its shell. Black food represents a bridge from our ties to traditions in the motherland to our wildest dreams that will manifest in the future. Black food is meant to live alongside you not only on coffee tables, credenzas, and nightstands. Toss it in your bag, satchel, purse, or on the passenger seat and ride out to your local farmer's market and grocery store. Level up your skills with practical cooking know-how shared by our brilliant chefs. Expand your African diasporic cooking repertoire and impress your family and friends. Pass it around at cookouts, barbecues, and family reunions. Like Black people, this book contains multitudes.
Thank you, Bryant. So Black Food, which you just read from, came out in October 2021.
Yep.
It was the most critically acclaimed cookbook of 2021 for North America. That's quite an accomplishment.
Yes, sir.
And as Novella read in your bio, you have accolades up the wazoo. You are quite busy, as I know as your friend. And I remember when you called me summer of 2020, and with all that you have going on, as accomplished as you are, you're a very laid-back kind of dude, usually. But when you called me that day, this is, I don't know, June 2020,
Yep. You
were like, talking really fast and a little bit frantic, and I was like, what is going on here? And you're asking me if I could write the chapter about Kay Bacante, who is the owner of Red Bay Coffee, a Black-owned coffee company. And of course I said yes, but can you talk a little bit about how long you had been thinking about this idea for a book, but then why there was that sense of urgency come the summer of 2020?
Sure. In order for me to talk about this book, I have to talk about this residency that I've had at the Museum of the African Diaspora in San Francisco. Do y'all know about MOAD? Okay, come to the Bay. Y'all have to come to MOAD. But MOAD is a special museum. Linda Harrison, the former executive director, really understood the need for this museum to be more than a space that just exhibits contemporary art, I don't know if you all are aware of the dynamics happening in the Bay Area, but because of gentrification and the tech industry and exorbitant housing costs, there's been a massive outmigration of Black folks from San Francisco, Oakland, Berkeley, these places where people have grown up for generations because folks simply can't afford to live there anymore. And Linda really wanted to see the museum as a space of refuge, as a place where people can come learn and grow. And so we created this Chef in Residence program. The first program we did, and I was very intentional about this, was a panel discussion, Black Women, Food, and Power. And I really wanted to celebrate the contributions of Black women in the historical production and distribution and consumption of food and food knowledge. We had some scholars, some activists, we had a farmer, anthropologist on the thing. And I knew that this program was special because, I mean, it didn't surprise me that we had people flying, coming from LA or the Pacific Northwest, but the fact that we had people flying in from the East Coast for a two-hour program at this small but mighty museum, it really showed me that there was a hunger, pun intended, for this type of programming. And so I had always thought about how we could take this brilliant and magical programming at the museum and put it in book form. Because back then, this was 2015, we didn't have the infrastructure for virtual programming. And it was really this ethos that if you come to the museum, you got a chance to see the programming and it stood in that time. And if you didn't, you come back. So fast forward to 2020 on the heels of what people are describing as this racial reckoning. And, you know, with the state murders of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, I started feeling a sense of urgency to get this book out. And then what really pushed me over the edge was, I don't know if you all heard about this, there was a lot of revelations of racism in the publishing industry. Did you all hear about this? Specifically in food media. So some of the legacy food media magazines were being called out for some just horrible racism and failure to protect their Black and BIPOC employees. But then some of the publishing imprints were also getting called out for just treating their Black employees and their Black authors really horribly. We could talk for hours about that. But I told my publisher, this was the time. We needed to get this book out. And I just want to say this to this audience, because I feel like this audience can hear it in a different way than a lot of other audiences I've been speaking to since October. I was very clear as a historian that we have these moments where America, corporations, this definition is embarrassed. And like a lot of people were embarrassed because their racism was being called out. And I was very clear that there was going to be this moment where the door was opening because they had to fix it. They had to do their PR spin. They had to, create some type of, the reputational harm that they suffered. They had to fix it. And so I told my agent that we're going to get this book deal, but we also need to pitch me having my own publishing imprint. Because it was a dream that I had for like a long time, but it was always this, well, when I retire from writing books, then I'll move into publishing. The funny thing is, I often talk about like how I feel like that door has been closing, because look, you're gonna be seeing a barrage of books by Black authors, whether in fiction, nonfiction. A lot of cookbooks are gonna be coming out, because in 2020 and 2021, they were giving out major deals. But then I talked to a friend, a journalist, and she said the door's already closed. She said there was like a waterfall of work in 2020 and 2021, and she said now it's slowed down to a trickle. And so that was the main reason that I felt like we had to get this publishing imprint, because it's bigger than me publishing a book, but it's about, one, creating more opportunities for Black folks and other folks of color who've been historically shut out of the mainstream publishing world to be able to publish their works. But it was also about ensuring that we can model a different way that publishing can happen. Publishing is right. I mean, there's so many inefficiencies and things that don't work. And so I really want my publishing imprint to show a new way. And so
Can I ask you a question? So this is skipping ahead a little bit. But when you say that you want Four Color Books, which is your editor-in-chief, it's the imprint, it's under 10 Speed, which is part of Penguin Random House.
Sure.
So what is the excuse that the current publishing industry gives for not giving more Black authors, Black chefs that space, especially in the food space?
They don't have vision. They don't understand the internal logic of our culture and how we operate and what we're drawn to and the history and culture of the way we move. I'll give you a prime example. My second book, Vegan Soul Kitchen, which was published in 2009, when my literary agent and I shopped that book around in 2007, we shopped it around to 12 publishers. We got 10 rejections, right? And what the response was, you're cutting the pie too thinly. Black folks, vegan, do black folks even eat vegetables? Like, that was the energy that we were getting from folks. And, you know, while in the popular imagination, we like to imagine veganism as this kind of like traditionally more of a white suburban practice, more recently, you know, young white hipsters living in urban gentrified centers. But because I grew up in a strong black community in Memphis, everything around me was black. The first encounter with veganism was from black Seventh-day Adventists in our community. And then, you know, I often talk about this thread of black-led food and health activism throughout the 20th century that's erased, that's largely ignored. But we could talk about the theologically driven efforts around abandoning the standard American diet and eating more, you know, whole foods, plant-centered diets. Look, when I went through my, I feel like it was an obligatory period of many men of my generation of reading the autobiography of Malcolm X and being kind of obsessed with the Nation of Islam after that, I learned about Elijah Muhammad and his two-book collection, How to Eat to Live. And then we can look at Rastafarians and their Itao diet that's plant-based and rejects commercialized food and largely natural. We can look at the efforts of the social justice activist and comedian Dick Gregory and the work that he was doing in the 1970s. He wrote a book, Cooking with Mother Nature, you know, talking about eating plant-based, rejecting the standard American diet. Listen, when I was in high school, as much as people vilify hip-hop, the impetus, the kind of catalyst for me even thinking about food came from listening to this hip-hop song by Boogie Down Productions, Seminole Bronx hip-hop crew. I don't know if y'all heard this song, Beef. This is back in the 90s. I heard this song. I had no idea about the way in which our industrialized food system operated. And then I heard these lyrics, Beef, what a relief. When will this poisonous product cease? This is another public service announcement. You can believe it or you can doubt it. Let us begin now with the cow, the way that it gets to your plate and how. The cow doesn't grow fast enough for man, so through his greed, he creates a faster plan. He has drugs to make the cow grow quicker. Through the stress, the cow gets sicker. 21 different drugs are pumped into the cow in one big lump. And just before it dies, it cries in the slaughterhouse full of germs and flies. And it gets much more graphic, so I'll stop there. But I think the point that I'm trying to make is that so often these mainstream institutions who aren't in our culture, who don't understand our culture, who aren't a part of the internal logic of our culture, they shouldn't be the ones who are shepherding in our cultural productions. They shouldn't be the ones who are deciding what's worthy of being produced or supported and celebrated. And I think we need people of color and black folks in these positions of power because we understand what the needs of our community are, what the longings, what the desires are, what people really want. And so I think as a black publisher, I'll be more adept at helping to bring in more voices that have traditionally been shut out of publishing.
So along those lines, you said...
I think we're going to have a Q&A towards the end of the thing.
Yes, we will, yeah. You said you created black food with zero concern for the white gaze. What do you mean by that? And then also, how does that manifest in the book? How does it look different, literally, and feel different?
So, you know, this idea of being unconcerned with the white gaze, I think so often black creatives are in these positions where we feel like we need to translate things or we need to make it make sense for the wider culture. And I'm glad that we're in a place where we're seeing more films and series and books and other cultural productions where people are just like, forget that. We don't need to do that. But I was very clear when I reached out to the more than 100 contributors throughout the black diaspora, inviting them to be a part of this book. One, I shared this quote by Toni Morrison in which he challenges us to think about what our lives would look like without racism. What if we aren't carrying this albatross of white supremacy around our necks? You know, what is our joy, our magic, our agency, our brilliance and creativity that's often, we're so distracted with dealing with racism on a daily basis, microaggressions, macroaggressions. Mm-hmm. And so I said to folks that This is a book, it's FUBU. It's for us, by us. I want us to be speaking to each other, and we can invite the world in, but I don't want any, like, one iota of this impulse to feel like we have to explain or talk to the wider culture, but this is about us talking to each other, not just here in North America, but throughout the African diaspora. Thank you.
We just heard you spit a little bit. Was that KRS-One?
That was KRS-One. Y'all know about, we got some hip-hop hands in the audience? Three people? Okay, great.
All right.
look up Boogie Down Productions. They're the best. They're like...
Can you talk more about how music is intertwined with your experience in the kitchen and also the history of black people cooking, black culture in the kitchen, and music? And most of your cookbooks, this book is number 5 or 6?
Number 6.
And so you had 5 cookbooks previously, and most of them have playlists.
Yeah.
So can you talk a little bit about why music is important to you?
So one of the signatures of my body of work is every recipe, I'll couple it with a song that might have inspired the dish, or that, you know, I just think you just have to be listening to Miles Davis Kind of Blue when you're making these collard greens or whatever. But I come from a musical family. My Uncle Don was a house songwriter for High Records, this seminal soul music label in Memphis. My aunt is Ann Peebles. You might have heard one of her classics, I Can't Stand the Rain. So when I was growing up, music and food were always intertwined. When we had family gatherings, and I think this is something that's like a part of a lot of black families. When you have gatherings, people are eating, people are like listening to music or dancing and singing. You know, it's just like this kind of melding of like all the things that make us human. And I think one of the approaches has been really helping us to reintegrate a lot of things that our industrialized food system has stripped from food. Food has become this commodity, and it's on one side. And all these things that have traditionally been so central to the way that we cook food and we grow food and we eat it, whether it's art, culture, community, building table around the family with kinship networks, I feel like I really want to help us think about how we can bring those things back together. You know, food shouldn't be this kind of like fuel for us to be part of this capitalist machine. It shouldn't be something that, you know, is enriching the 5 multinational corporations that largely control our food system. It's our human right to be able to grow our own food and to cook food in the traditional ways that our cultures have prepared them, and to build community around the table and not just be stuffing our face in the car or over the sink on the way from one low-wage job to the next one. And so I have these soundtracks, and if you're interested, if you don't have Spotify, you can go to Spotify, and there's a black food playlist with the whole playlist on there. But it's also just a way to really help us to kind of like viscerally connect with food and building around the table. And so, that's just been a cornerstone of the work.
You just said it's our right to grow our own food. And I know that part of your ethos is that good food is an everyday right, not a privilege. So how does having an imprint that's geared at a black audience and is mostly, I think, going to be black chefs, or
no,
black contributors?
No,
it'll contributors be like of color.
Folks of color, yeah.
how does that speak to that ethos?
So I just want to, because a lot of people know me through my cookbooks or media appearances, but I just want to be clear, my work in the food space started as a grassroots activist. Back in 2001, I founded this organization called Be Healthy in New York City. You guys know The Door in Lower Manhattan? It's a multi-service youth agency. Have you heard of that? So we were based at The Door, and we use cooking as a way to politicize and empower young people who are living in communities that had very little access to healthy, fresh, affordable, and culturally appropriate food. My work was inspired by the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. You know, when I was a graduate student at NYU, I knew that they were more than the way that the popular media and the government kind of created this propaganda to make them just these, you know, loud-talking, gun-toting militants. But Do you all know that they had over 60 programs called their survival programs? You guys know about that, the Black Panthers? They had over 60 programs that were aimed at meeting the basic needs of people living in communities. And they had such a forward-thinking analysis that looked at this intersection of poverty, malnutrition, and institutional racism. They had grocery giveaways where they were giving away thousands of pounds of groceries to low-income residents of the Bay Area. And then they had their free breakfast for children program. Have y'all heard about this? So I see we got some old head Panthers in the audience, but so respect. But their free breakfast for children program was started in 1968 in that January of that year. And it was that the aim was to feed children a hot, nourishing breakfast every single morning. Does anybody in the audience have a problem with feeding children a hot, nourishing breakfast every single morning, especially young people living on the margins? Right. I don't think so, but you know who did? The U.S. government. J. Edgar Hoover, who was the head of the FBI at the time, said that the Free Breakfast for Children program was the most dangerous threat to the internal security of the United States. When Chairman Fred Hampton in Chicago founded the program there, the day before they were set to launch it, the Chicago Police Department raided the space where they had the food. They trashed the food, urinated on it, dumped it in a garbage can. This is how opposed they are to like self-determination. The Black folks saying that even if this system doesn't want to take care of us, we are going to take care of ourselves. And so I say all that to say that, you know, my work with young people, you know, really pushing this food justice movement forward. And to be clear, you know, when we talk about food justice, it moves beyond advocacy and direct service, and it calls for organized responses that are owned and driven by the people who are most affected by food apartheid. And I say food apartheid because I'm sure you've heard this term, food deserts, but that's largely been rejected by food justice activists because people are using food apartheid in its place because food apartheid puts squarely into focus the structural barriers that prevent communities from being healthy and fed and taken care of. They're physical, they're economic, they're geographic barriers that prevent folks from having access to healthy food. But we know you go into a lot of low-income Black and brown communities and you see fast food restaurants on every corner. You see bodegas that have a lot of processed foods and packaged foods, a lot of foods that are high in sugar and high in salt. So I'm saying all that to say that because my work in food started as a grassroots activist, I have this lens of base building through everything that I do, whether it's writing book or media appearances. Ultimately, I do care about my career because I have a family and mortgages, but the most important thing to me is growing this movement so that everyone has access to the basic human right of healthy food, clean water, clean air. And so whether it's writing book or making TV appearances, like, I'm always standing on the shoulders of the Black Panthers and the work that they do. And I invite you all to be a part of this movement, too, because the reality is that many of us might have the resources to, you know, eat every day. But a lot of people, not only do they not have access to organic and locally grown food, too many of us do not know where our next meals come from. And this is one of the things that's so criminal. 80% of the people who are living on the margins and dealing with hunger and food insecurity are people who work in our food system. The people who are slaving in the fields and harvesting our vegetables. The people who are working in the restaurants for, you know, below a minimum wage, certainly not a living wage. So I think that if we can't ensure that the people who are actually ensuring that we have the most abundant and diverse food supply in the world, if they can't eat, if they can't be fed, if they can have access to all the things that we all have a human right to, then this thing is just terribly wrong and broken. So my invitation, join this food justice movement.
Thank you, Bryant. I got the 10-minute warning about 5 minutes ago that we're going to open it up to the audience to ask questions. But my last question before we turn it over is what you're excited about. What's coming up next?
So Black Food is my last book. I always said I wanted to go out on the top, and given that it was the most critically acclaimed book of last year, and, you know, I think the most thing, we could talk about the awards that we won and all that, the sales, But the most important thing is this book has resonated with the people. Like, I get emails every week from old people, young people in between, talking about the impact that this book has had on their lives, talking about the way in which they feel seen, and not just in North America. I get messages from people across the African continent, in the Caribbean, in Latin America. So the book did what it did, what I hoped it would do. But the next thing I want to do is focus on being a good publisher. This is a new thing for me. I know how to be a good author. So it's a huge learning curve. I'm also going to be a visiting scholar and resident artist at UC Berkeley next year in the African American Studies Department. So I'm really excited about just figuring out what the next decade is going to look like for me and just spending a lot of time with my family.
Okay, great. I guess we'll take questions now. You right here in the front.
What does publishing imprint mean?
So, right now, so the question was, what does a publishing imprint mean? So, and this is why we need antitrust law. Well, we need people to like, so anyway. Right now, Penguin Random House is the biggest publisher in the world. They've gobbled up and acquired a lot of, you know, different publishing houses. And no disrespect, but I just think that we don't need to have, like, that kind of concentrated power because, for obvious reasons. But imprints are kind of sub-publishing arms within the larger publishing houses that typically have more of a kind of, like, a specific slant or focus. And so Four Color Books, my imprint, the kind of tagline that I used when I pitched it was for people of color, for coloring outside the lines, and for beautifully illustrated, colorful books. And so we are starting publishing mostly cookbooks and food-related books because that's my wheelhouse. But I want to publish everything that I'm interested in, from poetry to prescriptive nonfiction to self-help. In fact, the second book that we acquired was from this Brooklyn-based photographer, Adrian Baril. He has this book coming out in 2024 called The Black Yearbook. Last fall, he traveled to educational institutions across North America, from Ivy League schools to trade schools, and he talked to and photographed provosts and students and staff, and really just trying to document what black life looks like in these educational institutions in the 21st century. So that's it.
Other questions? Go ahead. Woman with the sunglasses on.
Well, I'll start with food justice movement, and I'll say this. I think a lot of us, because of the in-up response of the U.S. government to this public health crisis over the past 2 years, a lot of people didn't have any faith in the U.S. government, but I think what little faith they did have is just, like, evaporated. And because of the further concentration of wealth at the top, because of the widening wealth gap, I think a lot of people are just feeling like these systems that have pretended like they're meant to take care of us, they simply aren't. And so there's no illusions anymore. And what I'm seeing, which I think is the direction that we need to head in, is a lot of people who are creating systems outside of these current systems. They're creating systems, people are buying up land, they're putting energy into local food systems, creating systems that don't rely on fiat currency, but have more of a communalistic way of taking care of us. Because I think a lot of people feel like if we don't take care of us, if we're not ensuring our communities are held and held, then no one will. And so I think that's been the kind of shift in the food justice movement, where we just have to be self-determined in the ways that, you know, we talk about Fannie Lou Hamer, and most people imagine her as this, you know, voting rights activist. But in the book, we talk about, there's an essay about her efforts around food and health. She bought up over 600 acres of land in Mississippi. She was teaching black folks about farming. She had, you know, dwellings so that people could be housed. She was just doing this revolutionary work, and a lot of it was centered on food. And I think folks are looking back to those type of models and understanding that that is one of the paths to our liberation. But in terms of publishing, it remains to be seen. You know, I think that a lot of people feel like the publishing industry is getting back to their old ways, where they aren't listening to BIPOC folks. They aren't hearing the needs of the audiences, and they're not going to be publishing the volume of books that they probably will over the next couple of years because they're pulling back on the deals. They're giving smaller advances. And so I don't know what they're doing, but I know what we will be doing, and it's modeling a different way. It's showing that you can support BIPOC folks, you can tell interesting and thought-provoking stories, and they can sell, and they can do well. And I think Black food is a testament to this. We had to fight for that cover. The cookbook industry is so set on the like traditional models and the way that they do things. They wanted us to have like some basic cover with some little corny dish on the cover, and I was like, no. We need something that's provocative, that is lyrical, and that speaks to the diversity and the complexity and the brilliance of this book. And I feel like this cover really did that. Y'all feeling this? Okay.
Any other questions?
I think we have one more question. Oh, just one more, and then we got to wrap up.
We can't hear you.
Oh, there are like two competing questions. I'm sorry. Okay.
Let's go here and then here.
Okay, sister, do you want to go ahead and go first? Yeah. Well, sister, I'm sorry. They're asking us to wrap up, so I think I can only address your first one. So let me just address that first question. So she asked, is the U.S. government, the USDA supporting Black farmers? The USDA has been undermining Black farmers throughout the 20th century. And recently, I don't know if you heard, but there were a lot of government subsidies that were going towards agriculture, like farmers, and there was going to be massive, like millions of dollars going to Black farmers to help support their work. But guess what happened? White farmers challenged it in court. They were so incensed that Black farmers, who have been like exploited and unsupported at every turn, they were so incensed that the U.S. government was going to give them some supports that they took it to court, and then they are fighting it tooth and nail. And so right now, these millions of dollars, it may have been billions that were going to Black farmers.
It was $4 billion.
$4 billion that was going to Black farmers is not going to them because white farmers have pushed back against it and challenged in court. So that's a whole other story. Thank you all. I will be signing copies of Black food over there. I really appreciate it. Look, I need to be in an audience. I love all my people. Human race, but it makes me so good to be speaking to so many Black folks. So thank y'all.